Welcome everyone. My name is Frans Volkvoort and thank you for this invitation. I'm working at the Tilburg University in the Netherlands and also at Open Evidence, which is a spin-off. And they are based in Barcelona and Milan. And today I will be talking about the effects of food marketing on eating behavior. And as you can see, and probably most of you will know, is that we have an obesity crisis. And we currently are also facing, of course, a COVID-19 crisis. But for many years now, maybe even decades, there has been an alarming increase of people who are overweight and obese. We see that this is not an issue in specific countries, but as this map already shows, and this is a map of a few years ago, so this is, has increased the last few years as well. We see that in many countries, there is a large probability that people will become overweight or obese. And one of the factors is, of course, that people do not eat well. Their nutritional intake is very unhealthy. And next to the fact that this leads to a high level of overweight and obese individuals, we also see that already children do not consume enough fruit and vegetables, and therefore they have a higher probability to become chronically sick. One of the things that is influencing eating behavior is food marketing. And as you can see in this figure, which easily shows that the majority of food marketing is spent on unhealthy foods. Actually, those foods that we should eat to a limited extent. We see that in this figure, and of course, there are different estimations that have been done also by the WHO, but all these numbers, they easily show that most of the advertising is spent on unhealthy foods, which should be consumed to a very limited extent. And these foods that have been promoted by health nutritionists and also dietitians, for example, fruits and vegetables, these are hardly marketed in different platforms. So as we can see, also this influences the eating behavior of people, and this as a consequence leads to the problems that we have seen before. And as you can see also with this currently epidemic in Corona, we see that especially people who are overweight or obese, they are much more susceptible to be influenced to a large extent than people with a normal weight who have a healthier eating pattern. One of the things that food marketers use are these famous people. This is a very famous Formula One driver. It's called Max Verstappen, and he races for Red Bull. But there are also other examples that Red Bull uses, and they do this to create some kind of brand image, that they are cool, that they are very sportive, that they are popular, that they are there to take risks, they are daredevils. So all this brand building influences the intake of this specific food product. And probably you also know that many children and adolescents consume these drinks, which contain a lot of sugar, but also caffeine and different nutritional ingredients that are not that healthy for them. And then, of course, the main question is, do you think that Max Verstappen will also drink this kind of food drinks before his match or during his data? And I bet he doesn't, because you know the influence of this this drink before a match. Subsequently, we also see that there are other popular sports celebrity stars that promote unhealthy foods, like this basketball player, but also Beyoncé, who promotes Pepsi. And Pepsi also has one of the most famous football stars in their list, which is called Lionel Messi. He has over 100 million followers, and he also promotes Pepsi continuously, together with Lay's. Then we have this example of Sharapova. This is a famous tennis star who also launched her own candy line. It's called Sugarpova. And when she was playing the US Open a few years ago, she even tried to rename herself from Sharapova to Sugarpova. Of course, as a commercial stunt to make this brand more aware among the consumers. But of course, this is not the only case. We also see, and this is, I think, the biggest challenge and also the biggest difficulty for many people to buy healthy foods is that we see that this food marketing is omnipresent. So we see these celebrity stars on television and commercials, but also, of course, during their races or during their matches. We also see them, of course, on Instagram if you follow these people. And as I already said, Lionel Messi has over 200 million followers. So probably many people will see these branded content. And then we also see these commercials on television combined with some kind of celebrations. And in this case, McDonald's Christmas. We also see that during Christmas time, this Coca-Cola advertising is extensively increased, both on the television, but also in the supermarket, to make it easier for you to buy this kind of food. We also see that food marketing has developed. They are not sitting still. They are continuously developing the tools and techniques that they use in order to increase their sales. And one of the things that they are doing is using the online platform. So next to the social media, you also see these games. On the left side, you see an ad for game. These are games created on a branded content. So they use one of the brands and the products to create a game, mostly popular games. So they copy a popular game, and then they use their own brands and products in that game to be assured of entertaining aspects. So on the left side, you see a Pepsi game where you have to race and you have to collect as many Pepsi bars as possible. On the right side, you see the McDonald's where you have to create a McDonald's world. And in the Netherlands, we had a big discussion last week because maybe you know, but in the Netherlands, we see that children are not reading a lot and they're also not enjoying reading, especially young children are not doing that. And I think that this is something happening across Europe, but especially in the Netherlands, we see that also in comparison to other countries, they are doing not that good. So one of the things that they have created the last few years is they have designed this Children Books Week. So then they try to promote reading books on schools, but also outside school. But one of the largest sponsors of this week has been McDonald's. So now if you go to McDonald's, you normally get a present, but in this case, you get a book. Just a small book, of course, branded with McDonald's. And there was a big discussion whether or not this was a good idea. And of course, you can make up your mind yourself, but I was not very fond of that. And I was also interviewed to discuss about it, because I think this is not solving the issue. It's solving maybe the issue of reading not enough. But in addition, it creates a different problem, which is, of course, that children think it's okay and it's normal to go to McDonald's. In the last few years, I studied food marketing to a large extent, and I developed together with colleagues this theoretical model. And of course, for now, this is not the main topic, but what I want to show you is that in all the food advertising, all the food marketing, you see that there are embedded food cues. So as you saw in the games, you saw the brand of McDonald's, or you see products of McDonald's or Pepsi or any other brand. And these are called food cues. And these lead to a subconscious reactivity called reactivity theory. And what you see is that both physiologically and psychological responses are activated as a result of this advertising. And as a consequence, this leads to a subsequent intake. And maybe you find this figure very complicated. And of course, I can talk about this for many hours. And normally I do this also with my students. But for now, I think it's very good to take an example to make it also more comprehensible. So these are my two daughters. And when she became 5 last summer, she, of course, got this cake. But then if you see the reaction of the youngest one, that's very, and this was by accident because we took this picture not being aware of this reaction, of course. This reaction was conducted subconsciously. So she saw the cake, how both physiological and psychological reactions activated her to wanting and needing the cake. And subsequently, of course, she would eat the cake. And this is, of course, an example of simply presenting food to someone. But this same mechanism is happening also when you see a food commercial, but then in a more subconscious manner. Maybe you think, yes, okay, but this was just one example. But then the second photo that I made a few weeks after we saw the same. And of course, this only happens with palatable food. So food that are high in sugar, salt, and fat. And all, what we have seen in one of the first slides is that this kind of food are also promoted much more than healthier food, like, for example, fruit and vegetables. So what we see is that these foods with high fat, sugar, and salt are overconsumed, but they also overmarketed. So in almost all of the food marketing, you see that these foods are promoted. Subsequently, we also see that children between 8 and 12 years old in the Netherlands, but I see this across Europe, eat not enough fruit and vegetables. Although this is, of course, necessary to have a healthy life afterwards. So one of the things that we were wondering ourselves was whether you can use the same techniques that have been used by unhealthy food marketeers for healthy food marketing. So one of the things we have developed is this theoretical model, and we just heard that this has been accepted in a scientific journal. We see that we assume that if you promote this fruit and vegetables, this will lead to, again, a physiological and psychological reward and attention processes. So hopefully, if you make it more entertaining and more salient, people will increasingly like it. They will also spend more attention in it. And subsequently, we hope, of course, that this will increase the intake of this fruit and vegetables. What we see from the literature is that once children or people start eating fruit and vegetables, they also like it, especially after 5, 6, 7 times. And then they create something like a habit formation. And this habit formation means that you normalize it so that you will create a habit. So always in the breakfast, you eat strawberries or blueberries because this is part of your daily routine. And then subsequently, in the break, you will eat an apple or a banana because this is also part of your routine. And if you increase this consumption of fruit and vegetables, this will become more normal. At least that is what we expect. If this will take place, then of course, subsequently, we will see that their health will improve. So all the different measurements that we are now seeing that are decreasing, so people are really becoming more sick and they get chronic diseases, but you will probably know more about that than me. But this is a great issue that can be solved if people, and then especially children, will improve their healthy eating behavior. And this is something that we want to target through fruit and vegetable promotion. What we also see, and this is also what we showed already in the previous theoretical model, is that this individual and contextual factors are very important. So for example, some of the children already consume fruit and vegetables on a daily basis, or they also consume healthier foods on a daily basis. But we also see that especially people in specific groups do not consume enough fruit and vegetables. So they are especially the ones that we need to target to improve their lifestyle. So there are several options, and these are based on, for example, on nudging. So one of the things is nudging is that you make it easier. For example, if you use this already prepared foods, which already also has been used for unhealthy foods, you see that people are more prone to eating these foods easily than if you make it too difficult. The same thing is that what has been conducted in the US is they try to use the same techniques that they have used for unhealthy food marketing for healthy food marketing. So what if you could make broccoli more cool instead of you need to eat it because it's healthy for you? And then, of course, you also have examples that are used in the Netherlands. These are Dutch examples. We see that these combinations of easiness, but also easy to prepare, with a high level of nutrition foods, makes it much more easier for people to consume these foods subsequently. So, and then also we see that if you make it that easy and also tasteful, because these foods really taste very well, then people are willing to eat these foods. So now we see that there are different opportunities that can be investigated by future scientific research in order to show whether or not the same food marketing techniques that have been used for unhealthy foods can also be effective for healthy foods. This is, for example, something that my children really like. So these are the 3 different snacks you can choose. So people have this perception of autonomy. They are already cut and washed, so you can easily eat it also along the way, because nowadays everyone is busy. So this is a very easy option to consume. And of course, if you eat only this package of vegetables, you already consumed your daily intake of vegetables. Other examples are, for example, this water bottle that are very popular among children in the Netherlands. And also in the supermarket, you see that there is a free option to take apples and bananas to consume for children. They also put these characters there to make it more popular and that it becomes more salient. So also the stores, they are working together with the scientific researcher to try to improve the intake of the population. This was my presentation. Thank you for your attention. And I hope that that there are many questions that I can answer for you.
Très bien, je vous remercie beaucoup. Merci, c'était vraiment une présentation très très intéressante et qui faisait, expliquait des faits très intéressants du point de vue du marketing et des enfants et du marketing en général. J'ai une question, nous avons une question immédiate qui a été reçue en ce qui concerne le prix. Le prix, c'est souvent cité comme étant une barrière, un obstacle à la consommation accrue de fruits et légumes. Les gens ont l'impression que les fruits et légumes, pour ce qu'ils sont, sont chers. Qu'est-ce que vous répondriez à ce moment-là quant à cette question du prix? Oui, le prix, les prix, c'est un facteur très important, comme on le sait tous, et on a d'ailleurs fait plusieurs études montrant que le prix est un facteur très important qui explique le comportement en matière de consommation. Mais je pense également c'est basé sur un biais cognitif, parce que les fruits et légumes, quand on, en fait, ne sont pas si chers que ça. Si on calcule le prix par rapport à leur valeur nutritionnelle, si l'on regarde l'information nutritionnelle concernant ces prix, on voit que ces produits sont encore moins chers qu'ils ne le sont parce qu'ils ont, ils apportent donc des ajouts, des apports supplémentaires, en particulier ils ont une longue durée de vie. Nous savons par exemple qu'aux Pays-Bas, ils ne coûtent pas cher du tout. Beaucoup moins cher, par exemple, que même l'eau en supermarché ou les autres boissons en supermarché. Donc, il y a plusieurs options qui montrent que l'alimentation saine est moins chère que l'alimentation malsaine. Et dans les exemples que j'ai montrés, les légumes que j'ai montrés ne coûtent pas cher. Et les légumes que les fruits et légumes que les enfants peuvent produire, qui sont présentés comme je vous l'ai montré, ne sont pas chers non plus. Alors, il y a souvent un mauvais calcul ou un biais cognitif qui influence ce point de vue. Oui, quelquefois, c'est difficile, en tout cas en Europe, de faire des publicités comparatives. Quelquefois, on aimerait bien dire, avec 2 euros, on peut avoir beaucoup plus de fruits et légumes, alors que vous payez 2, 3 ou 4 euros pour de la junk food, pour de la malbouffe. Très bien, nous avons encore une autre question. Concernant la faible consommation, vous l'avez fait remarquer, et d'autres personnes l'ont dit également, qu'il y a une proportion très importante de personnes qui consomment vraiment très très peu de fruits et légumes. Alors la question est la suivante. Qu'est-ce que nous savons sur ce public? Quel est leur profil? Quelles sont leurs caractéristiques? Est-ce que l'on peut faire peut-être des interventions plus ciblées sur ces personnes pour encourager la consommation parmi ces consommateurs très faibles de fruits et légumes? Excellente question à nouveau. Et là, je crois que c'est le cas également aux Pays-Bas et dans toute l'Union européenne, mais également dans d'autres parties des États-Unis. Nous voyons tout particulièrement que les personnes de faible statut socio-économique ne mangent pas assez de fruits et légumes. Donc, c'est le domaine principal que l'on doit cibler. Une des options, une des études que nous avons faites aux Pays-Bas, et nous avons beaucoup de confiance, c'est un score. Par exemple, nous avons le déjeuner à la cantine qui peut jouer un rôle très très important, qui peut relever le score d'absorption. Si vous pouvez fournir à l'école suffisamment de fruits et légumes gratuitement ou bien pour une quantité très faible d'argent, c'est si bénéfique. Beaucoup d'enfants de milieux défavorisés vont manger ces fruits et légumes qui leur sont offerts à l'école. De plus, on a appris par les intervenants précédents que les 1000 premiers jours de la vie sont particulièrement importants. Et les modèles de consommation sont très, très importants également. Et le mode de consommation. Donc, il est important de considérer la globalité de ces aspects. Et en particulier, les enfants des milieux plus défavorisés doivent être particulièrement ciblés. Eh bien, merci beaucoup. C'était vraiment d'excellentes réponses à ces problèmes importants. Et maintenant, j'ai une question. En ce qui concerne Sugarpova et l'utilisation des célébrités pour faire la promotion de junk food, de malbouffe, est-ce qu'on a des exemples positifs, au contraire, ou est-ce qu'il y a une stratégie qui peut être mise en place pour enrôler en quelque sorte des personnes, des sportifs bien connus pour encourager un bon régime alimentaire? Alors, c'est difficile. Je sais que Sharapova était une des stars qui faisait la promotion d'Evian. Et en tant que citoyen néerlandais, je préfère promouvoir l'eau du robinet parce que c'est meilleur pour la santé. Mais aux Pays-Bas, un des problèmes qui a été identifié, c'est que les fruits et légumes n'ont pas de marque. L'identification à la marque est un facteur très important pour faire du marketing. C'est difficile d'attribuer une marque aux fruits et légumes. Ils n'ont pas de marque. Ils ne disposent pas de marque. Et jusqu'à présent, il n'y a pas eu de célébrité qui faisait la promotion, malheureusement, des fruits et légumes, en tout cas sur une grande envergure. Eh bien, si j'ai bien raison, et je vais demander aux organisateurs, nous avons atteint le bon moment maintenant pour donner la parole à la présentation suivante qui va être faite par monsieur ou par madame Touvier.